Norwich, September 1919. Seated opposite me in the railway carriage, the elderly lady was recalling some of the murders she had committed over the years.
"There was the vicar in Leeds," she said, smiling, "and the actress from London, of course."
"That was one of my favourites," I replied.
"I know you, don't I?"
she asked, sitting forward.
"I work for Mr. Pinton at the Wisby Press," I told her. "My name's Tristan Sadler. We met at a literary lunch."
"Yes, I remember now."
"I'm a great admirer," I added. "As is Mr. Pinton. He's talked several times about trying to lure you over to our house."
"Yes, I know Pinton. Vile little man. I can see why he employed you there."
I raised an eyebrow, confused.
"Pinton likes to be surrounded by beautiful things," she explained. "You remind me of his last assistant, the scandalous one. But I am perfectly happy with my publisher, thank you."
She sat back now, her expression turning to ice, and I knew I had disgraced myself, turning what had been a pleasant exchange into a potential business transaction. I sat silent for the rest of the journey. I emerged from the great stone walls of Thorpe Station and found that the street where my lodgings were located was nearby. Upon arriving, however, I was disappointed to find that my room was not ready.
"Oh, dear," said Mrs. Cantwell, the landlady, trembling slightly. "The room should have been ready hours ago, only... Oh, well, we had a bit of unpleasantness this morning, Mr. Sadler. That's the truth of it, in your room. Or what was to be your room, that is. You probably won't want it now."
I was about to ask if there was anything I could do to help, when a door behind her opened and a boy of about 17 appeared.
"I told you to call me when the gentleman arrived, didn't I, Ma?" he said, glaring at her. "What have you told him?"
"Well, I haven't told him anything, David. I didn't know what to say."
"Oh, I do apologise, Mr. Sadler," he said, turning to me now. "But, might I speak with you in private?"
"Very well." I followed him to the far side of the hall, partly intrigued by the measure of concern on display, partly aggrieved by it. I was tired after my journey and filled with such conflicting emotions about my reasons for being in Norwich that I wanted nothing more than to be left alone with my thoughts. "Look," I said, "perhaps if you could just explain the problem. I did send a postal order to reserve the room."
"Oh, of course you did, sir," he replied. "We were to put you in number 4, you see. Number 4 is the quietest room." "I read your letter, sir, and took you for an army man. Was I right, sir?"
I nodded curtly. "I was, but not any more."
"Well, sir, our girl Mary is up there at the moment disinfecting everything, and it will be good as new by the time she's done with it, but... Well, I believe it would be disrespectful of me not to tell you what's gone on there."
I was intrigued now. A murder, perhaps? A suicide?
"Well, he stayed here before, Mr. Charters. A very respectable chap, I always thought. Works in a bank in London. But there was something of a commotion early this morning."
He lowered his voice.
"It turned out that Mr. Charters went out last night, but he didn't come home alone. And we have a rule about that sort of thing, of course."
I couldn't help but smile. "Is that all?"
"Not quite all, sir," said David. "For Mr. Charters' companion, shall we say, was a thief. Robbed him blind, and when he protested, held a knife to his throat, and all hell broke loose. Ma woke up, I woke up, and the other guests. Well, we called the police, of course. They were both taken away."
"The poor man," I said. "I can understand the young lady being arrested, but why on earth was he?"
"Mr. Sadler," said David calmly, "I think you've misunderstood me. Mr. Charter's companion was not a young lady. It was a boy."
He nodded knowingly at me, and I looked away. "Ah, I see that."
"And it does leave the matter of the room," he said delicately.
"It really doesn't bother me, and I am in need of a bed."
"Oh, then it's settled," he said cheerfully.
I followed him across to the reception counter.
Would you care to sign the register, sir? I nodded and leant over the book, writing my name carefully, the ink splashing as I struggled to control my grip of the pen in my spasmodic right hand.
You can wait in the drawing room if you wish, said David, staring at my trembling index finger. And once again, please accept my apologies. The world's a funny place, sir, isn't it? You never know what kind of deviance you're dealing with.
My room at Mrs. Cantwell's boarding house, the infamous number 4, was a bleak setting for the apparently dramatic events of the previous night. The wallpaper, a lacklustre print of drooping hyacinths, spoke of better, more cheerful times, while the carpet was threadbare. In the corner stood a wash basin with a fresh bar of soap and a clean towel. I stripped off my clothes and washed my face and body. Cleanliness, hygiene, the marks of a good soldier. Such things came instinctively to me now. A tall mirror was positioned in the corner of the room, and I stood in front of it, examining my body with a critical eye. Scars stood out, red and livid across my legs and abdomen. I felt desperately unattractive. Once, I knew I had not been so ugly. When I was a boy, people thought me pleasant to look at. Thinking of this brought Peter Wallace to my mind. Peter and I had been best friends when we were boys, and with thoughts of Peter, it was but a short stroll to Sylvia Carter, whose first appearance on our street when we were both 15 was the catalyst for my last. During that summer, we went swimming together, and Peter and I attracted Sylvia's flirtatious remarks. Alone with her once, she told me that I was the best-looking boy she had ever seen, and that whenever she saw me climbing from the pool, my body sleek with water, it gave her the shivers. The remark had both excited and repelled me, and when we kissed, the thought passed through my mind that if a girl like Sylvia, who was a catch, could find me attractive, then perhaps I wasn't too bad. The idea thrilled me, but as I lay in bed at night, I imagined scenarios of the most lurid kind, none of which involved Sylvia at all. And I would swallow back my tears as I wondered what was wrong with me. What the hell was wrong with me anyway? The kiss was the only one we ever shared. For a week later, she and Peter declared they were in love. I was mad with envy, and seeing the pair of them together left me in bitter twists of anguish, feeling nothing but hatred for them both. I pulled my shorts and vest on now, unwilling to sleep naked. I didn't want the sensation of Mrs. Cantwell's well-worn sheets against my body. I couldn't abide any touch that might suggest intimacy. I was 20 years old, and had already decided that that part of my life was over. How stupid of me. Twice in love and twice destroyed by it. And at the thought of that second love, I collapsed onto the floor and wrapped my arms around my knees, scrunching my eyes tightly as the terrible images returned. Why did I come here? I wondered. What was I thinking? If it was redemption I sought, there was none to be found. If it was understanding, there was no one who could offer it. If it was forgiveness, I deserved none. I awoke early the following morning, after a surprisingly undisturbed night, and I felt a little more confident about what lay ahead. Not wishing to engage in conversation, I decided against taking breakfast in the boarding house and instead crept out of the house shortly after 9. The morning was brisk and bright. I'd never been to Norwich before, and I purchased a small printed map from a street stall. My appointment was not until 1 o'clock, which left me ample time to see a few local sights. I crossed the bridge on Prince of Wales Road and continued northwards, turning through an area that identified itself by the rather morbid name of Tombland, and on towards the great spire of Norwich Cathedral. A small cafe attracted my notice, and with a reminder that I had eaten no breakfast, I decided to stop for something to eat, waiting only a few moments in the window seat before a rosy-cheeked woman came over to take my order. I regretted not having brought a book with me, but instead I watched as the passers-by went about their business. The street was filled mostly with women doing their early morning shopping. I thought about my mother, about how she cleaned the flat every morning at this time when I was growing up, while my father took up position in the butcher's shop downstairs, carving up the fresh joints. I'd been terrified of everything associated with my father's job. The bone sores, the animal carcasses, the blood-stained overalls. And my squeamishness did not endear me much to him. He hoped that I would follow him into the family business, but it never came to pass. I was expelled from home at the age of 15 and only returned once, more than 2 years later, just before I left for France. "The truth is, Tristan," my father said that day as he steered me carefully out onto the street, "it would be best for all of us if the Germans shoot you dead on sight." The last thing he ever said to me. When I left the cafe, I continued in the direction of the cathedral. As I stood inside the precinct walls, looking up at the magnificent monastic building, footsteps on the gravel alerted me to the approach of someone. Two people, in fact. I pretended to be looking at the stained glass windows. "We should be making the final list by 3 o'clock, the young man was saying to his older companion.
"Well, I'll have my say. I promise you that,"
the other man replied insistently.
"Of course, Reverend Bancroft," came the reply. "Everyone there understands your pain and grief."
"Nonsense," snapped the man. "They understand nothing. But I will have my say. But I need to get home quickly afterwards. My daughter has arranged something. Well, it's difficult to explain. She gets these notions."
At that moment, the Reverend caught my eye.
"Good morning, young man," he said,
and I stared at him, my heart beating faster inside my chest.
"Good morning," he repeated, stepping towards me, smiling. "Are you all right? You look as if you've seen a ghost."
I opened my mouth, unsure how to reply, and then I turned on my heels and ran. How could I have been so stupid? How could I have not remembered? It was all so unexpected, though. The name, Reverend Bancroft, and then the expression on his face. The likeness was uncanny. I might have been back on the training grounds at Aldershot or the trenches of Picardy. It might have been that dreadful morning when I ascended from the holding cells in a terrible, vengeful fury. It was time to start making my way back across the city for my appointment. The war had been over almost 9 months when I finally plucked up the courage to write to Marian Bancroft. A part of me wanted to dismiss her from my thoughts entirely, to pretend that she and her family did not exist. What possible comfort could I offer after all? But one day, tortured by guilt, I composed a letter. "Dear Miss Bancroft, you don't know me, but I was a friend of your brother, Will. We were in the same regiment. I must apologize for writing to you out of the blue like this, but I have something belonging to Will that I thought I should return. The letters you wrote him while he was over there. He kept them all, you see, and they fell to me. Afterwards, I mean, on account of our friendship. If you would perhaps permit me to call on you some day, then I could return them. Your brother was my best friend, and I know that he was no coward, Miss Bancroft. He was a braver man than I will ever be. With respectful wishes, Tristan Sadler." It was almost 2 weeks before I received a reply.
Dear Mr. Sadler, thank you for writing to me. I apologise for taking so long to reply, but your letter both upset and moved me in unexpected ways. You speak very kindly of Will, and I was tremendously affected by this. But I'm afraid I have a very contradictory feeling towards our soldiers. I respect them, of course, but when I think of what they did to my brother... The letters. I can't believe you have them. It is very kind that you want to return them to me, and your offer to come here is a generous one.
And so it was that later that month, just before 1 o'clock, I found myself sitting in the window of a cafe just off Cattle Market Street, waiting for Marian Bancroft. The door opened, and I looked up, amazed by the sudden fright it gave me. My stomach was rolling with anxiety, and I suddenly dreaded this encounter. But it was a young man who had come inside, and he stared at me in an almost feral fashion before moving from my sight line. I picked up a container of napkins from the table for something to do, and my right hand immediately broke into a fresh spasm, and the napkins fell to the floor. I reached down to pick them up, which is how I failed to notice when the door opened again, and a young lady entered and made her way towards me.
"Mr. Sadler," she said. And I looked up, staring at her. Words failing me now. Words failing me.
Aldershot, April to June 1916. I notice Will Bancroft on our first day at Aldershot Military Barracks. We arrive in the afternoon, some 40 of us, a group of untidy boys stinking of sweat and bogus heroism. "Just look at them," says the boy next to me. "Bloody fools, all of them." I turn to look at him. He's tall, with a studious appearance. "Tristan Sadler," I say, extending a hand. He shakes it and nods.
"Arthur Wolfe. I bet you volunteered, didn't you? Just turned 18, are you?"
"Yes," I lie. In fact, my 18th birthday is 5 months away, but I have no intention of admitting it here. A moment later, I sense a commotion in the ranks, and I watch as three men in uniform stride towards us.
"Good afternoon, gentlemen,"
says the man in the centre.
"Follow me, won't you?"
We gather into a pack and shuffle along behind him.
"Looks like he's the one in charge,"
Wolfe says, nodding towards the sergeant. We stop now in the centre of the parade ground, and the sergeant and his two corporals turn to face us.
"Let me begin by welcoming you to Aldershot. My name is Sergeant James Clayton, and over the next couple of months it is my responsibility to train you into soldiers. You, sir,"
he says, pointing at a lad in the front row.
"Your name, please?"
"Mickey Rich,"
says the boy confidently.
"Mickey Rich, sir,"
shouts the soldier, standing at the sergeant's left shoulder.
"It's all right, Corporal Wells,"
the sergeant says cheerfully.
"Rich doesn't understand our ways yet. He's ignorant, aren't you, Rich?"
"Yes, sir."
The sergeant nods at a second man.
"Who are you?"
"Shield, sir."
"You?"
"Philip Unsworth, sir."
"You?"
"Will Bancroft, sir."
And so on and so on, a litany of names.
"And you?"
the sergeant asks, nodding in my direction now.
"Tristan Sadler, sir," I say.
"Arthur Wolfe,"
says my neighbour.
"Wolfe,"
says Sergeant Clayton, his mouth creasing into a thin smile.
"So you're the chap who doesn't want to be here, yes?"
"That's right, sir."
"Afraid to fight, are you?"
"No, sir."
"No, sir, indeed not, sir. What an outrageous charge, sir."
"I expect to hear from the tribunal quite soon, sir."
"Actually, it is I who shall hear, Wolfe,"
snaps the sergeant. He addresses the pack now.
"I'm sure you're all proud to be here, men. But you're probably aware that there are some men who feel no obligation to defend their country. Objectors, they call themselves. Chaps who examine their conscience and find nothing there to satisfy the call of duty. They look like other men, of course. They have two eyes and two ears, two arms and two legs. No balls, though. That's a given. And they would bring us down if they could.
Bloody coward,
says a voice from behind me.
Featherman,
says another. I watch to see how Wolf will react to the taunts, and it's then that I lay eyes on Will Bancroft. He's standing four men down from me and staring at Wolf. He isn't joining in the chorus of disapproval. It's as if he wants to get the mark of someone who calls himself a conscientious objector. I find myself staring at Bancroft, unable to shift my gaze. It's a strange moment. I feel as if I already know him.
Come up here, Wolf,
says Sergeant Clayton.
And you, Mr. Rich.
The two men step forward.
Gentlemen,
says Sergeant Clayton, looking towards the assembled men.
In this army, you will be trained to fight, to handle a rifle and to kill the enemy. But sometimes you may find you have no weapons left. You have nothing but your fists. What do you think you would do, Shields?
He says, addressing one of the recruits.
Fight it out, sir.
Exactly,
says the sergeant.
Fight it out. Now, you two.
And he nods in the direction of Wolf and Rich.
Fight it out!
Both Rich and Wolf turn to each other, the latter with an expression of disbelief on his face. But Rich doesn't hesitate and punches Wolf directly on the nose.
Ah! You've broken my bloody nose!
Cries Wolf, blood pouring from his nostrils.
So break his in return,
says Sergeant Clayton casually. Wolf waits a few seconds, breathing heavily, controlling his temper, before shaking his head.
I won't fight, sir.
Hit him again, Rich.
And now Wolf is punched again in the stomach, and then once more in the ribs, and he's on the floor. The men watch, uncertain how they should feel about the whole thing. Even Rich steps back.
For pity's sake,
says Sergeant Clayton, shaking his head contemptuously.
All right, Rich, get back into line. And you, Wolf, get up, for God's sake. He barely touched you.
Wolf rises to his feet and shuffles back into line next to me. He catches my eye. Perhaps he sees the expression of concern there, but he looks away. He wants no pity. My first contact with Will Bancroft comes the following morning. We're divided into barracks of 20 men. I have the last but one bunk on one side. Will is next to me against the wall. I've never shared a room with anyone, let alone 19 other young men, and I'm convinced it will be impossible to sleep. But to my surprise, my head has barely hit the pillow, and then it's morning, and our two corporals, Wells and Moody, are screaming at us to make our way quick smart to the medical tent for an inspection. Drifting outside, Will and I fall into line with each other, and he extends a hand to me. Will Bancroft, he says.
Tristan Sadler.
Looks like we're to be neighbours.
You don't snore, do you?
I don't know, I reply. You? I'm told when I lay on my back I could raise the roof.
How many brothers do you have then? I ask, assuming they had told him of his nocturnal habits.
None. Just a sister. You? I hesitate, feel a lump in my throat, unsure whether to answer truthfully or not. My sister Laura, I say, and leave it at that. I was always glad of my sister, Will says, smiling. She's a few years older, but we look out for each other. She's made me promise to write to her regularly while I'm over here. I nod, examining him closer now. He's a good-looking fellow with a mess of dark, untidy hair and bright blue eyes. What did you make of our friend Wolf, then? He says as we stride on. Pretty brave of him, wouldn't you say?
Pretty stupid.
Still, you have to admire him. Have you ever known a conscientious objector?
No. Have you?
One. The older brother of a school friend. Refused to take up arms on religious grounds. They sent him off to the front as a stretcher-bearer.
That seems fair, I say.
only until you realise that a stretcher bearer has a life expectancy of about 10 minutes. Snipers pick them off easily. Doesn't seem quite so fair now, does it? I frown and consider it. I want to reply carefully, for I already know that it's important to me that Will Bancroft thinks well of me and adopts me as his friend. I could have tried the religious thing myself, he adds. The part as a vicar, you see, up in Norwich. He wanted me to go into the church too. And you didn't fancy it? No, I don't mind soldiering. At least I don't think I'll mind it. Oop, watch out, here we are. We step inside the medical hut, where Moody splits us into groups. Will and I are among the first to be examined. The doctor indicates that Will should strip out of his clothes, and he does so without embarrassment. Without thinking how it might look, I take him all in at a glance and am struck once again by how good-looking he is. Out of nowhere, I have a sudden flashback to that afternoon at my former school. The day of my expulsion, a memory still buried deep inside me. After our medicals, we return to the barracks. Will and I lie on our bunks. What did you think of that doctor then? He says. I didn't think anything of him. Why? I just thought you seemed very interested in what he was doing. That's all. Not planning on joining the medical corps, are you? I feel my face begin to blush. He had caught me staring at him. No, no, Bancroft. I'm sticking with the regiment. Glad to hear it, Tristan, he says. It's good to have made a friend. And for God's sake, stop calling me Bancroft. My name's Will. I know every bugger here calls each other by their surnames, but we are different, I think. Let's not let them break us. All right? Over the weeks that follow, we endure such tortuous training that I can't believe that this is something I had wanted to be a part of for so long. Our reveille comes most mornings at 5 o'clock, when we're expected to jump from our beds and dress and line up in formation outside the barracks, ready for a 4-hour hike. I form good relations with most of the men, but it's to Will that I cleave most mornings, and he appears content to spend his time with me too. I haven't experienced much friendship in my life. The only one who ever mattered to me was Peter. But he abandoned me twice, first for Sylvia and then after the incident at school. My subsequent disgrace ensured that I would never lay eyes on him again. Perhaps it's not unusual then that I find myself seething with jealousy on an early morning march when I find that Will is walking ahead with none other than Wolf, our conscientious objector. I stare at them in surprise, for no one ever walks or talks with Wolf, on whose bed small white feathers appear every night. I fall into line next to them. Tristan, Will says cheerfully. Arthur was just telling me about his plans for the future. Oh, yes? I ask, looking at Wolf. Planning on making a run for the papacy, are you? Steady on, Tristan, says Will. You know the part as a vicar, nothing wrong with the church. No, no, of course not, I say, having momentarily forgotten the sainted Reverend Bancroft. Not the priesthood, no, says Wolf, enjoying my discomfort. I thought politics. Politics? Why not? Well, if a fellow were to stand for Parliament in my constituency and he refused to fight... But Arthur isn't refusing to fight, says Will. He's here, isn't he? I'm here training, insists Wolf. I've told you, Will, when we're shipped out, I'll refuse to fight. The military tribunal was supposed to make a decision on my case weeks ago. What exactly are you objecting to? I ask. You don't like war, is that it? Nobody should like war, Sadler. And I can't imagine that anyone really does, except for Sergeant Clayton, perhaps. No,
I simply don't believe that it is right to take another man's life in cold blood.
But my dear fellow, says Will, then it'll be the stretcher-bearer's job for you.
Well, if it's the only alternative. Small use to politics you'll be if you're picked off by a sniper, I say. And Will turns on me then, frowning, and I feel ashamed. I look away, unable to bear my friend's approbation.
Something the matter, Sadler? Asks Wolf, as Will advances forward.
No.
We were just talking, he says casually. I'm not trying to steal him away from you.
I stare at him, unable to find words to express my indignation, and he bursts out laughing as he marches away. The day that our uniforms arrive, Will and I have been rostered for guard duty. Every man in the troop has been given new boots, two thick grey shirts, a pair of khaki trousers, and a heavy overcoat. It's in this fine new set of clothing that Will and I stand guard.
What about poor old Wolf then, Tristan? Did you ever see anything so disgusting?
Earlier in the day, when Wells and Moody were distributing the uniforms, Wolf found himself with a shirt that was too large and trousers that were too tight. He looked like a clown, and the entire troop, save Will, was reduced to tears of laughter. I only stopped myself from joining in the hysteria through my desire not to have Will think badly of me.
He brings it on himself, I say.
Why do you always take his side?
Well, the man actually talks a lot of sense, Will replies quietly. And damn it all, he has a right to his opinion. I don't like the way he's treated, that's all. But let's not talk about it anymore.
Hey, guess what today is?
I think about it.
Your birthday?
Lucky guess. How old are you then?
You know full well, Tristan, I'm only a few months older than you.
19.
19 years old and never been kissed,
I say without really thinking about the words, and ignoring the fact that he is not, in fact, a few months older than me, but nearly a year and a half.
Steady on, old man, he says quickly.
I've been kissed all right.
Why, haven't you?
Well, of course,
I say. Sylvia Carter had kissed me after all, and there had been one other, both utter disasters.
Now, if I was at home, Will says then, I expect my parents will be throwing a party for me and inviting the neighbours. And Eleanor, of course.
Who's Eleanor?
Eleanor's my fiancée. I've told you about her, haven't I?
I stare at him. I know full well that he has never mentioned her, and can see from the expression on his face that he knows the same thing.
Your fiancée?
Well, in a manner of speaking. We've been sweethearts for ever so long. She's a terrific girl and not at all conventional. I can't stand conventional girls. Can you, Tristan?
No, I say, digging the toe of my boot into the dirt, imagining for a moment that the soil is Eleanor's head.
I'm not entirely sure I know what he means when he says that she is not conventional, but then I remember him telling me that he has been told that he snores something terrible, and the phrase attacks me like a viper as I realize exactly what it is he's saying.
Don't you have a sweetheart at home then, Tristan?
You know I don't.
What's the matter? You're not jealous, are you?
He says, laughing at the absurdity of it.
Of course I'm not jealous.
I want to say more, but I know that I can't. I was just hurt that you didn't tell me about her, that's all, I say eventually.
I don't like secrets.
But it wasn't a secret, he says quietly. He steps closer, then puts a hand out and touches me gently on the arm. He looks up at me, his face caught in a mixture of confusion and sadness. He opens his mouth to say something, but then he changes his mind and turns away, shaking his arm as if he wants to rattle it loose.
For Christ's sake, Tristan,
he hisses, and walks away from me into the darkness. My 9 weeks at Aldershot are almost at an end, and I wake up in the middle of the night for the first time since my arrival. In another 36 hours we are due to pass out, but it's not anxiety about what lies ahead that breaks my sleep. It's the sound of a muffled commotion coming from across the room, an unsettling reverberation of dragging and kicking, then silence. and I fall asleep again. At drill the following morning, as Sergeant Clayton orders us into our ranks, there is an empty place. A soldier, AWOL.
Does anyone know where Wolf is?
Sergeant Clayton asks. There is silence.
Well, I might as well tell you that our self-proclaimed conscientious objector has disappeared. Taken himself off into the night like the coward that he is. But we'll find him. I can promise you that.
I don't for a moment think that Wolf has absconded, but my mind is on other things. Will we be dispatched to France immediately? Will I live another week? These are far more pressing concerns to me than whether or not Wolf has made a bid for freedom. I'm in Will's company, walking back later that afternoon towards the barracks, when Hobbs comes bounding over to us.
They found Wolf!
Where? Asks Will. Is he all right?
About 4 miles from here, replies Hobbs. In the forest where we went on marches.
Up there? I ask in surprise. For it's an unpleasant place filled with freezing cold streams. There's no place to hide out.
He wasn't hiding, Sadler. He was found there. Wolf's dead.
Dead? I ask. But how?
I haven't got the full story yet, replies Hobbs. But it seems he was discovered face down in a stream, his head split open. Must have been trying to run away, tripped over a rock and fell face forwards. Anyway, he's gone now, and good riddance, I say, to our resident feather man.
My instincts kick in, and I grab Will's arm just as he lashes out to punch Hobbs in the face.
What's the matter with you? Asks Hobbs, jumping back. Don't tell me you've signed up to this rot too.
Will struggles against my arm for a moment, and only when I feel his muscles relax do I release him. I watch him, though, as he glares at Hobbs, pure anger in his face, before he turns and marches away. When Will hasn't returned by nightfall, I go in search of him. It's our last night together as recruits, and we've been given the evening off. Some of the men I know have gone into the nearby village to the pub, and I decide to check there first. As it happens, I don't need to go that far, for halfway there, I discover him by chance in one of the clearings in the woods. He's sitting in the moonlight by a stream. Will, I say, running towards him. I've been worried about you. Have you? He asks, looking up. And I can see that he's been crying. Sorry, I just needed to be alone for a while. It's all right, I say, sitting down beside him. He lets out a deep sigh and rubs his eyes before turning to me with a sad smile on his face. So here we are, the end of the road. Was it worth it, do you think? We'll find out soon enough, when we get to France. France, yes, he says thoughtfully. It's all in front of us now. I believe Sergeant Clayton would be disappointed if we weren't all killed in the line of duty. Don't say that, I reply with a shudder. I'm sure he doesn't want to see any of us dead. He wanted Wolf dead, that's for sure. Wolf killed himself. Perhaps not on purpose, but only an idiot would go into the forest in the middle of the night. Oh, Tristan, you really are unbelievably innocent at times. Wolf didn't kill himself. He didn't fall, he was murdered. Killed in cold blood.
For God's sake, Will, he deserted the camp.
He hadn't run anywhere, he said angrily. He told me only a few hours earlier that he'd been granted his status as a conscientious objector. He wasn't even being sent out there as a stretcher bearer. Turns out he was quite adept at mathematics and had agreed to help in the war department under house arrest. He was going home, Tristan, the very next morning, and then just like that, he disappears. Who else knew about this? I ask. Clayton, of course. Wells and Moody. And then I remember the noises that I heard in the night. The kicking of the blankets. The dragging along the floor. Jesus. Now you have it, Will says in an exhausted tone. But what can we do about it anyway? Nothing. A moment later, his head is buried in his hands and I realize he is weeping. What's going to happen to us out there, Tristan? I'm scared shitless, honest I am. He reaches over with both hands and pulls me to him. In my idle moments imagining such a scene, I have always assumed that I would reach for him and he would pull away, denouncing me as a degenerate and false friend. But now, I'm neither shocked nor surprised by his initiative. It feels perfectly natural, everything that happens between us. And for the first time since that dreadful afternoon when my father beat me to within an inch of my life, I feel that I have come home. September 1919. Miss Bancroft, I said, returning the fallen napkins to the table and standing up. I extended a hand, and she stared at it before shaking it in a brisk, business-like fashion. You found it all right, then? She asked, and I nodded. I arrived last night, actually. Shall we sit down? Can you excuse me for a moment, Mr. Sadler? She said, taking off her coat. I just want to freshen up. She walked towards a side door. I suspected that she had planned this manoeuvre. Step inside, say hello, size me up, disappear for a few minutes to gather her thoughts. As I waited, a young couple entered and sat down at a nearby table. I noticed a large burn mark on the young man's face and averted my gaze. In the far corner, I was dimly aware of the man who had come in earlier, staring in my direction, but then he moved out of view. I'm sorry to have kept you waiting, said Marian Bancroft, returning to the table now and sitting down. As she did so, the young couple glanced across and whispered something to each other. Then they stood up, throwing unpleasant looks at us, and moved to a table by the furthest wall. Marian watched them go, before turning back to me with a curious expression on her face, a mixture of pain, resignation, and fury. Did you say you arrived last night? Yes, I said, on the late afternoon train. She smiled and looked away a moment. Was it awful? She said eventually, and I looked up, surprised that she should ask a loaded question so soon. The train journey, she added quickly, noticing my disquiet. Of course, it was natural that we should make small talk at first. It was hardly as if we could get straight into the reason for my visit. I didn't mind it, I said. I met someone I vaguely knew. She reached in her bag and removed a cigarette case, plucked out a cigarette, and offered a second to me. I shook my head. You don't smoke? She asked, lighting up. I do, but I won't just now, if you don't mind. Why should I mind? Oh, hello, Jane. Good morning.
Good morning, Marianne,
said the waitress who had approached. At tea for two, Jane. The waitress nodded and walked away. Jane is sweet. She used to play with me and... She stopped herself, and her face fell as if she couldn't quite believe what she had been about to say. She took a drag from her tab, then pressed it out in the ashtray. Do you know, I'm rather thinking of giving these things up. We didn't speak for a while, and it gave me an opportunity to examine her more closely. She was about 25, I imagined, but there was no wedding ring on her finger, so I assumed she was still unmarried. She didn't look very much like Will. He had been so dark and cheeky-looking, but she was much fairer. She looked over towards the counter where there was no sign of the waitress. I'm thirsty. What's keeping her? I'm sure she'll only be a moment, I said. In truth,
I was starting to feel rather unsettled and wondered why on earth I had decided to come here in the first place. It was clear that neither of us felt relaxed in the other's company. Miss Bancroft, Marian, drummed her fingers on the table and looked at the half-smoked cigarette. Eventually, she pulled open her bag and reached again for her cigarette case, which, when she retrieved it, slipped out of her hands and fell to the ground, scattering cigarettes around our feet. "Oh, hell! Look what I've done now!" In a moment, Jane, our waitress, was beside us, reaching down to help gather them. "Never mind them, Jane," Miss Bancroft snapped. "I can pick them up. Can we just get our tea, please?" The arrival of the tea allowed us to focus on something trivial for a few minutes, rather than being forced to talk. Marian was clearly in a state of great tension and anxiety. In my selfishness, I had considered little but my own preoccupations before we met, but Will, after all, was her brother, and he was dead. "I'm sorry, Mr. Sadler," she said after a long silence, smiling across at me. "I can be an awful old hag sometimes."
"There's nothing to apologise for, Miss Bancroft. This is not the most comfortable situation."
"No," she agreed. "Can I ask you to call me Marian?"
"Of course. And I'm Tristan."
"Well, Tristan," she hesitated, bit her lip. "I suppose I should ask why you wrote to me." I cleared my throat. "So here we are at last. I have something of Will's.
My letters, yes. I don't mean this to sound critical, but you have held on to them for rather a long time." "I assure you, I've never so much as opened an envelope."
"I don't doubt that for a moment. I wonder why you took so long to get in touch, that's all."
"I haven't been well, and I didn't feel I was up to meeting you."
She looked out of the window a moment, and then turned back to me. "Your letter came as more of a surprise to me than you might imagine. I had heard your name before."
"Oh, yes?" I asked cautiously.
"Yes. Will wrote often, you know, particularly when he was at Aldershot. He told us about his routines and about some of the men who were training with him. And the man in charge, Clayton?"
I felt my body grow rigid at the name. I wondered how much she knew of Sergeant Clayton's responsibility in the whole business.
"Yes," I said. "He was there from start to finish." "I'd show you the letters, Tristan, but they are rather private."
"Of course," I said, not realizing how much I wanted to read them until she told me that I couldn't. The truth was, I'd never really given much consideration to their content. At Aldershot, I had never written to anyone. But once, during the course of the French campaign, I wrote a long letter to my mother asking her forgiveness for the pain I had caused. I attached a note to my father, telling him I was well. But I never received a reply. For all I knew, he had been first to pick the letter off the mat some morning and had thrown it away before I could cast further shame on his household.
"Sergeant Clayton sounded like a terror," she remarked.
"He was a difficult man. When we were training, he was bad enough, but when we were over there..." I shook my head. "He'd been before, you see, and he'd lost 3 brothers in the fighting. But that doesn't excuse what he did."
"What did he do?"
I opened my mouth, fully aware that I was not yet ready to answer this question. I didn't know if I ever would be, for after all, to reveal Clayton's crime would be to admit my own. And I was here to return a packet of letters, I told myself. Nothing more. "Did your brother... did Will mention me much in those letters?" I asked after a moment.
"He certainly did. I remember in his first letter from Aldershot, he told me about the chap who had the bunk next to his. A Londoner, he said, but not a bad bloke all the same. He told me how you and he would pal around together, how you're always there for him. And then there was all that business with Mr. Wolfe."
"Oh, he told you about him, did he?"
"Not at first, but later.
I could tell he was interested in Mr. Wolfe's beliefs, and then after he was murdered.
It was never proven that Wolfe was murdered, I said irritably.
Well, there was no doubt in my brother's mind. And after that, the carefree boy I had known vanished, and in came this new chap. A chap who wanted to talk about right and wrong. He wanted to know what the newspapers were saying about the war, whether anyone was standing up for the rights of man, as he called them, over the sound of rifles. And then... well, you know what happened then.
I nodded and sighed as we sat very quietly for a few moments.
And did he... did he say anything more about me? I asked eventually. I might never get the chance again, and I had to know. I had to know how he felt. I'm sorry, Tristan, she said, looking a little shamefaced. I have a rather awful thing to tell you. Perhaps I shouldn't.
Please do.
The truth is that you were such a big part of his letters all through that time at Aldershot. He told me all the things you did together and made you sound like a pair of mischievous children. I thought he was rather besotted with you, to be honest, as preposterous as that sounds. But could feel my face turning into a rictus of pain instead. Then he wrote to say that you had all shipped out, she continued. And from that first letter after you all left Aldershot, he never mentioned you again. And because you'd been such a big part of his early letters, I asked whether you were still in the same regiment.
But you know we were, I said, confused.
Yes, but when he replied, he told me... I'm sorry, Mr. Sadler, Tristan. He said you'd been killed. He said that only 2 days after you left Aldershot, you were picked off by a sniper. I stared at her and began to feel dizzy. He said I was dead. It must have been someone else, she replied quickly. He must have just got it wrong. Anyway, as far as I was concerned, there was the two of you, thick as thieves, and off you go to France together, and the next thing I know, you're dead. And then, about 3 years later, out of the blue, your letter arrived. I turned and looked out of the window. Over the previous 12 months, I had felt such pain, such remorse over what happened to Will and my part in it. I had grieved so much, too, my feelings for him so intense that I feared I would never be able to see past them. And now to hear this, to hear that he had effectively killed me off from that moment after our last night together at Aldershot. I had believed that he could not have broken my heart any more than he had. But now there was this. There was this.
Mr. Sadler? Tristan?
I turned back to her and saw that Marian was looking at my right hand with a concerned expression. It was twitching uncontrollably. You'll have to excuse me, I said, standing up quickly.
Tristan,
I'll be back, I said, rushing towards the door to the gents on the opposite side of the room. I saw the man who had entered the cafe earlier suddenly jump to his feet and march hurriedly towards me.
I want a word with you, he said aggressively. Not now,
I snapped.
Get out of my way.
I won't get out of your way. Now look here.
Get out of my way,
I shouted. And I pushed the man roughly aside. He didn't struggle with me, and a few minutes later I locked myself in the lavatory and placed my head in my hands, devastated. I was not crying, but there was a word being repeated over and over, I thought in my head, but actually aloud, and I had to make a concerted effort to stop myself saying, Will, Will, Will. As I rocked back and forth, as if this was the only word that had ever mattered, the only syllable that had any meaning for me.
Thank you.
When I returned from the gents, I felt embarrassed by my behaviour, but was unsure whether Marian had even noticed how upset I had become. I didn't look in the direction of the man who had insisted on speaking with me, but I could sense his presence in the corner of the room and wondered who exactly he thought I was. At the table, Marian and our waitress Jane were deep in conversation.
"I was just apologising to Jane," explained Marian. "I was rude to her earlier. Jane was very kind to my parents. Afterwards, I mean."
"You knew Will?" I asked.
"I knew him since he was a boy. He was a couple of years behind me in school, but I had a right crush on him back then."
Jane smiled.
"Well, I'd better be getting on."
"She wasn't the only one, of course," Marian said as I sat down. "The only one of what?"
"Who is half crazed for love of my brother," she said, smiling. "You'd never believe the way the girls threw themselves at him."
I wasn't entirely sure that this was the line I wanted to pursue, but there was a part of me, a masochistic part, that could not help myself. "And he reciprocated their affections?" I asked.
"Sometimes. There was a string of them at one point."
"But there was a fiancé, wasn't there?"
"A fiancé?"
she asked, looking up at me and smiling at Jane as she placed a fresh pot of tea before us. "Yes. He told me once that he had a sweetheart back home."
"Are you sure? Did he say who she was?"
"I'm not sure I can recall," I said, although the name was firmly emblazoned in my memory. "I think it was Anne. No, wait, Eleanor. Yes, he said her name was Eleanor." Marian burst out laughing.
"Not Eleanor Martin?"
"I don't know the surname."
"But it must be her. Well, yes, Will and Eleanor did have a thing, I suppose, at one point. But Tristan, the girl has no more sense than a postage stamp. But he claimed they were engaged."
"Perhaps I have it wrong."
"You must have it wrong, Tristan. My brother would never have given up his life to share it with a fool such as Eleanor."
She glanced at my left hand and I caught her eye.
"You didn't have a sweetheart waiting for you then, back home?"
I shook my head.
"Well, so much the better for you, if you ask me. Love's a fool's game."
"But where would we be without love?" I said suddenly, surprised to hear myself say such a thing.
"You're a romantic, then?"
"I don't know. I know that I feel things deeply. Too deeply, in fact."
"But you young men all feel things so deeply now," she insisted. "Friends of mine, boys who fought over there, you have an intensity now, a potent sadness. Why is that?"
"Isn't it obvious?"
"Yes, to an extent. But I'd like to hear you explain it to me."
I thought about it. I wanted to be honest with her, or as honest as I dared to be. "Before I went over there," I said, looking away from her, "I knew someone. Forgive me, Marian, but I fell in love, I suppose. In a childish way. And I got very hurt by it. I thought I knew what I was doing and that the other party had similar feelings for me. I was wrong. Quite wrong. Then when I went over there and fell in with the regiment, fell in with your brother, well, I realised how silly I'd been back then. Because suddenly everything, life itself, became an intensely heightened experience. At Aldershot, they weren't teaching us how to fight, they were training us how to extend our lives for as long as possible. And when I wasn't killed, when I was one of the lucky ones..." "There were 20 of us in my barrack, you see, 20 boys, and only 2 came back. One who went mad, and myself. But that doesn't mean we survived it. I don't think I did survive it. I may not be buried in a French field, but I linger there. My spirit does, anyways. So am I a romantic? Do I think in terms of weddings and falling in love? No, I don't. After everything that has happened..."
"Tristan, stop,"
she said, reaching forward suddenly and taking my hand, which was shaking uncontrollably.
embarrassing me once again. I realized, too, that tears were working their way down my cheeks. "I shouldn't have asked you about this," she said. "Good Lord, you came all this way to meet me, and this is how I repay you. Can you forgive me?" I smiled and shrugged my shoulders. "There's nothing to forgive. It's just... well... can we get out of here? I feel like I need some fresh air."
"Of course. You don't have to go back to London yet, though, do you? I'm enjoying our talk."
"No, not yet."
"Good. It's such a beautiful day.
I could show you some of the places where Will and I grew up. And there's something I'd like you to do for me, but I'll tell you that later. If I ask you now, I think you'll refuse me." "All right," I agreed, getting up and taking my coat from the stand. "Let me pay for the teas," I said, "and I'll meet you outside."
"Were you a friend of Will's then?"
our waitress asked as she took my money. "Yes, we served together."
"It was a disgrace," she hissed. "What happened to him, I mean? Made me ashamed to be English. You won't get many around here that'll agree with me on that, but I knew him, and I knew what kind of man he was."
I swallowed and nodded.
"There's not many people I respect as much as I do Marian Bancroft," she continued. "Despite everything that happened, she offers such help to those ex-servicemen around her. You'd think, all things considered, that she'd hate them, but she doesn't."
I frowned, realising that I hadn't even asked Marian what she did in Norwich. It was typical of boys like me. We were so wrapped up in ourselves that we didn't think the world held a place for anyone else. I thanked Jane and said goodbye. Marian was waiting outside, but not alone. The man from the cafe was standing before her, gesticulating wildly. I walked quickly towards them. "Hello," I said. "Everything all right here?"
"You," said the man, raising his voice. "You!"
"Leonard," said Marian, "this has nothing to do with him. You leave it alone if you know what's good for you."
"Don't tell me what to do, Marian. You won't answer my letters, you won't speak to me when I call, and then you take up with someone else and flaunt it in front of my eyes."
"You've got everything wrong as usual," shouted Marian. "And what business is it of yours anyway, Leonard Legg?"
"You belong to me," he insisted.
"I don't belong to anyone, and least of all you. Do you think I ever want to look at you again after what you did?"
"After what I did," he said, laughing. "Oh, that's rich, that is. Why, even the fact that I'm willing to put the past in the past and still marry you should show you the kind of man I am. Why, if my parents even knew that I was talking to you, let alone forgiving you."
"You have nothing to forgive me for," she cried. "It's I who should forgive you. But I don't, and I never will."
He glared at her, breathing heavily. And for a second I thought that he was going to assault her, so I moved forward. And as I did so, he turned and punched me in the face, sending me sprawling to the ground.
"Tristan!" cried Marian. "Are you all right?"
"I think so," I said, sitting up and looking up at my assailant, every fibre of my being wanting to stand up and hit him back. But I didn't. Like Wolf, I would not fight.
"Come on," he said. "Get up and show me what you got."
"Get out of here, Leonard," said Marian, "or I'll call the police."
He laughed, but seemed a little disturbed by this suggestion. He spat on the ground.
"Coward,"
he said, looking down at me contemptuously.
"No wonder she likes you. It's what the Bancrofts go in for, after all, isn't it?"
"Just leave, Leonard, please," said Marian quietly.
He looked at her and then shook his head in contempt before making his way down one of the side streets and disappearing out of sight.
"I'm sorry," Marian said. "Tristan, I'm so, so sorry."
Later, when I was back on my feet, we began to walk along the streets of Norwich town centre. A slight bruise was forming on my cheek, but no serious damage had been done.
"You must think terribly of me," she said after a lengthy silence.
"It wasn't you who hit me. But you know that man, obviously."
"Oh, I know him all right. We were engaged to be married, you see. But he broke it off."
"Oh, don't look so surprised. You must realise why, surely. Will? She shrugged her shoulders as if she were embarrassed by it. I did love Leonard once. Before the war, he was a different person. It's hard to explain. I've known him since I was 15. We were always sweet on each other. And when he asked me to marry him, I said yes.
Was he over there?
No, he couldn't go. He's terribly short-sighted, you see. But to be fair to him, he was very cut up about it. I think he felt it made him less of a man.
Well, if he didn't get to fight then, he's certainly making up for it now, I said. I saw him earlier in the cafe. He was watching us.
If I'd known he was there, I would have left, she said. He wants me back, you see.
She took a deep breath.
You might as well know the story. His parents put the most awful pressure on him. They run a greengrocer's here in the town. Well, of course, everyone knew that Leonard and I were to be married. So after Will died, most of the town stopped shopping at Legs. They were looking for someone to attack. And it wasn't as if they could take it out on my father. He was their vicar. There were certain conventions that had to be upheld. So the Legs were the next best thing. Leonard and I tried to carry on for a while, but it was no good. Leonard threw me over for his family's sake. And now that things have begun to blow over, he's decided he wants me back.
She was raising her voice now.
Everyone around here wants to act as though nothing ever happened and there never was a boy called Will Bancroft who grew up around them and went out and fought their blasted war for them.
All right, I said, trying to calm her.
But people behave as though we're disgraced. Can you understand that? Look at that couple in the cafe. Their brazen rudeness, their insensitivity. Oh, Tristan, don't pretend you didn't notice. They moved away because of me. This is what I have to put up with every day. It's not as bad as it once was, that's true, but in a way it's even worse now that people are talking to me again. It says they've entirely forgotten Will, which I never shall. They treat my parents, they treat me like they want to say they forgive us, as if they think we have something to be forgiven for. But it's us who should be forgiving them for how they treated us and how they treated Will. And yet I don't say anything. I'm just as much a coward as they think my brother was. I want to defend him, but I can't.
Your brother was not a coward, I insisted. You must believe that, Marian.
Of course I believe it, she snapped. He was the bravest one of all. But try telling that to people here and see how far it gets you. They're ashamed of him, you see. The only boy from the entire country during the whole war ever to be lined up in front of a firing squad and executed for cowardice. They're ashamed of him. They don't understand who he is, who he was. They never have. But you do, Tristan, don't you? You know who he was.
July to September 1916. A cry of despair and weariness emanates from the pit of my stomach as the wall behind me begins to crumble and dissolve into a slow-moving river of thick, black, rat-infused mud that slides down my back and slips into my boots.
Over there!
Shouts Corporal Wells, pointing to where Parks, Hobbs and Denchley are attacking their pumps.
There's buckets, man! This whole area must be drained.
I nod quickly and reach down to pick up a bucket. And then a heavy body running too fast pushes past me and I fall, knocked head over feet, my face in the sludge and the water, and I think, how can this be? How can my life have descended into such filth and squalor? A hand reaches down to help me up. Then there's a great rush of water in my face. My bucket is thrust back into my hands, and I turn to see who has helped me. His face is filthy, almost unrecognizable. But I catch his eye for a moment, and we stare at each other. Will Bancroft and I,
and say not a word before he turns away and presses on further along the trench. I try to count the days since I left England and decide that it is 24. We took the train from Aldershot to Southampton the morning after passing out, but my mind was still focused on the events of the previous night. Afterwards, Will had dressed quickly and stared at me with an expression unlike any I had ever seen before. A mixture of surprise at what we had done, tainted by an inability to pretend that he had not only been a willing participant, but the prime mover. Will, I began reaching out for him, but he shrugged me off.
No,
he hissed, and disappeared into the night. When I returned to my bunk, he was in bed, his back turned towards me. And the following morning, when I awoke, he was already gone. There was no chance to talk to him on the train, and it was only later that night, as we sailed towards France, that I found him alone by the railings of the boat, his head bowed as if deep in thought. He didn't turn around, but I could tell that he knew it was me. Look, Sadler, it's no good, you know that, don't you?
Of course, it couldn't.
Look, let's just act as if none of it ever happened. We're soldiers now. We have a war to fight.
Back there, I said, nodding in the direction of England, our friendship meant a lot to me. I've never been good with friends, and...
Oh, for pity's sake, Tristan, he hissed, turning on me furiously. Don't speak to me like I'm your sweetheart, all right? It sickens me.
Well, I said, reaching out to him, but he slapped my arm aside and walked away.
Since then, we have barely spoken, and I have tried to forget him. I have tried to convince myself that it was just one of those things. But it's difficult to do that when my body is standing here, 8 feet deep in the earth of northern France, but my heart remains by a stream in a clearing in England, where I left it weeks ago.
Rich is dead. Parks and Denchley too. They were sent out on a wiring party last night and were picked off by German snipers. The trucks are due to arrive soon with replacement timbers for the trenches, and Corporal Moody sends me to help unload. As I march back to the reverse line, I see Sergeant Clayton standing, talking with three men. When I get closer, I realize that one of them is Will, one Turner, and the other a man with red hair who I've never seen before.
What's keeping those bloody trucks?
Snaps Sergeant Clayton, glancing at his watch.
I'll be at supervision, Bancroft. Come and find me when they get here.
Sir, says Will. I want to talk to him, but it's awkward here with Turner and the unknown redhead. I'm Rigby, announces the stranger, nodding in my direction. Sadler, I say.
Rigby's a feather man,
says Turner, as though it's the most natural thing. Really, I say. And yet you're still here all the same.
I've done 6 nights of stretcher duty in a row, he tells me, and I'm still alive, which I suspect is something of a record.
Will is walking around in circles, keeping his distance from me.
Rigby's a Londoner like you, says Turner.
Where from? I ask, turning to Rigby.
Brentford. Do you know it?
Yes. My family's from Chiswick. Sadler's butchers.
You're not Catherine Sadler's son, are you?
He asks, and I feel a little lightheaded to hear her name. All the way over here, in a field in France, with the bodies of Rich and Parks and Denchley decomposing a few hundred feet from where I stand.
That's right, I say, trying hard to maintain my composure.
How do you know my mother?
Well, I don't really, but my mother's friends with her. Gosh, Sadler.
I was terribly sorry to hear about your... It's quite all right, I say, unsure how best to pursue this conversation.
But I don't need to, because Will is beside us now. She's all right, is she, Mrs. Sadler? Asks Will.
Pink of health, as far as I know, says Rigby, turning back to me. But they've had a hard run of it. Hundreds of boys have fallen. Did you know Edward Mullins?
I nod. A boy from the year ahead of me at school.
Gassed to death. And Peter Wallace?
Peter Wallace, I say, careful to control the tremor in my voice. What happened to him?
Went down when the Nestor got hit. Sorry, Sadler. Was he a friend of yours then?
I look away and feel as if I might collapse with grief. So we are never to be reconciled. I am never to be forgiven. Yes, I say quietly.
A long bloody last, says Turner, suddenly pointing ahead. Here's the trucks. Shall I go and get the old man for you, Bancroft?
Please, says Will. And I can feel his eyes on me now. A good friend? He asks. Once, we grew up together. He was the only... Well, the best friend I had, I suppose. Rigby, sensing the awkwardness of the moment, follows Turner. Only when they're out of sight does Will step closer to me, and by now I am trembling, wanting to run away. Keep it together, Tristan, he tells me quietly, putting a hand on my shoulder, his fingers pressing tightly, sending a current of electricity through me despite my grief. Keep it together, yes? I move closer to him, and he pats my arm in consolation. What did Rigby mean when he said he was sorry to hear about... Well, he didn't finish his sentence.
It doesn't matter, I say, moving forward in my grief to put my head on his shoulder, and he pulls me to him for a moment, his hand at the back of my head.
But then Sergeant Clayton comes into sight, and we separate. I wipe the tears from my eyes and look at him. But he's turned away. The weeks pass. We advance. We stop. We entrench. We fire our guns and throw grenades. And nothing ever seems to change. I finish a shift of more than 10 hours and am dead on my feet one night when I make my way to the reverse. I see someone sitting alone in the corner of the mess and advance towards him. But I hesitate, when upon getting closer I see that it's Will. He's hunched over a sheet of papers, and he looks up. Tristan, he says, smiling, and he nods at the seat next to his. Writing home? I ask. I'm trying to write to my sister, Marian, he says, stuffing the papers in his pocket. It's usually small talk, but it fills the pages. You don't write home.
How do you know?
Well, I only meant I've never seen you write. Your parents, surely they'd like to hear from you. I shake my head. I don't think they would. I got thrown out, you see. Yes, I know, but you never told me why, Triss. Triss. One single syllable of intimacy and the world is put to rights. Haven't I? I say, and leave it at that. What about your sister? Laura, isn't it? I shake my head again and look down, wanting to tell him about Laura, but unable to. You've heard about Rigby, I suppose? He asks after a while. Yes. I was sorry to hear it. Bloody Clayton had it in for him from the start. The chaps don't like a feather man, I say half-heartedly. We're all feathermen at heart, Will replies. He extends his hand towards the candle that is burning before him and hovers his index finger in the air, passing it slowly through the flame. That night, he says quietly. Before, I mean. At Aldershot? Yes. Had you ever thought of it before? he asks, looking directly at me. I want to reach out and hold him, and tell him that if he will just be my friend again, then that is all I need. I can live without the rest if I have to. I had, I say. Yes, I think it's... Well, it's there in my head. I've tried to rid myself of it, of course. I hesitate, and he stares at me. It's no good, though. It was there before I even knew what it was. Ah, Tristan. He sighs, moving closer to me. And suddenly his mouth is on mine, urgently, and I almost fall backwards in surprise. Wait, he says, pulling away. Not here. Follow me. I stand and walk after him, practically run in case I lose him in the darkness of the night, moving so fast and to such a distance that a part of me worries whether this might be considered desertion. Another part is curious about how easily he finds this patch of hidden ground. Has he been here before? With someone else? Finally, however, he stops and turns to me, and as much as I want him, I remember that night at Aldershot and the way he looked at me afterwards. It will be all right this time, won't it? I ask.
Yes, yes, he says.
And I tell myself to ignore the voice in my head that says that this is simply a few minutes of pleasure in exchange for who knows how long of antipathy on his part, because it doesn't matter. At least for a few minutes, I can believe that we are no longer at war. Launching myself out into no man's land gets more terrifying every time. I crawl forward on my belly, my rifle before me. I can hear Wells or Moody, one of them, issuing orders further down the line. But it's difficult to make out exactly what he's saying because of the strong winds and rain. It's madness to go over in conditions like this. But the orders came through from GHQ... and are not to be questioned. It has been 3 weeks since my second encounter with Will, and he has neither spoken to me nor answered when I have addressed him. There's a sound of artillery fire up ahead.
Hold the line, comes the word from man to man, 19 or 20 of us in an uneven row as we get closer to the enemy trench.
The firing stops. A dim light can be seen, then a sound of muffled voices.
Another minute, and we are all on our feet, our rifles raised and primed, and now there is a constant sound of gunfire and the explosive light of our bullets shooting into the trench below. I rush forward, trip over a body and think, please, God, let it not be Will.
But no, when I look down, I see Unsworth. He's already dead.
Forward again. And we jump down, my first time in a German trench, screaming as we race through unfamiliar lanes, and I find myself shooting indiscriminately as I go. We're there for how long I don't know, but soon we've taken it. We've taken the German trench. They're dead all around us. And Sergeant Clayton tells us that we're good men, that we've done our duty as he trained us to do. But we have to continue.
Four of you will stay here, he says. Milton, Bancroft, Atling, Sadler, all right? Milton, take the lead. And if I come back and find that Fritz has retaken the trench, I will shoot the lot of you.
And in the madness of the moment, I burst out laughing. For in such an eventuality, we will have long since passed from this world into the next. Will disappears into one of the lanes with his rifle. I look around the trench. There are dead bodies everywhere, but I've lost any revulsion for corpses. I begin to wonder what Will is doing
when I hear the sound of boots marching through the mud, and he reappears, but not alone.
"Bloody hell," says Milton. "What you got there, Bancroft?"
"Found him hiding in one of the shelters," says Will, pushing forward a young boy who has a look of pure terror on his face.
"Better tie him up, I suppose," I say. "We can take him with us when we move on." "Take him with us?" asks Milton. "Why the hell would we do that?"
"Because he's a prisoner of war," says Will.
"Let's just get rid of him now and be done with it."
"We're not murderers," says Will sharply. Milton laughs, indicating the dead Germans at our feet.
"Stop playing the bloody saint, Bancroft, all right? He's a German, isn't he? He's the enemy. You know what our orders are. We kill the enemy."
"Not the ones we've captured, we don't," insists Will. "Will is right," I say.
"Who asked you, Sadler?" said Milton, sneering at me. "Bloody Bancroft says the moon is made of cheese, and you say, pass me the crackers, someone."
"Shut up, Milton," says Will.
"No,"
he replies angrily, grabbing the German boy's shoulder and dragging him towards him. He pulls his pistol from his belt. "Just put the gun down and let the boy go," Will says calmly, reaching for his pistol now. "For God's sake, man, just think about what you're doing. He's a child." Milton hesitates and looks at the boy. And I can see that for a moment there is a degree of compassion in his expression. But the German boy picks this moment to lose control of his bladder, and a heavy stream of piss darkens the leg of his trousers, the leg pressed against Milton, who looks down in disgust.
"Oh, for Christ's sake!"
he cries. And before any of us can do anything, he lifts the pistol to the boy's head and fires. It's the following night when Will approaches me. I've just finished eating. I'm exhausted. I haven't slept in 48 hours. For once when I see him, I don't feel any excitement. Just tension. "Tristan," he says, "can we talk?" "I'm tired." "Please, Tristan, it's important." He turns away, and of course I follow him. He walks down the line to where a row of stretchers are lying next to each other, the bodies atop them covered with the jackets of the fallen men. "What?" I ask. "I've spoken to the old man. About the German boy." "Oh," I say, nodding slowly. "That?" "Yes, that. It was cold-blooded murder. You know it was."
"It wasn't right, Will. Of course it wasn't. But these things happen."
"I've seen worse." I offer a brief, bitter laugh and look around at the stretchers. "What do you want me to do?" "I want you to tell Clayton what happened."
"But you've already told him."
"He refuses to believe me. He brought Milton and Atling in, and they both claim that the German boy tried to attack us, and that Milton had no choice but to shoot him in self-defense."
"They say that?"
"I'm for going to the general about it," continues Will. "But the old man says that's out of the question without anyone else to corroborate my story. I've said that you saw it all."
"Oh, Christ, Will," I hiss. "I don't want to get involved."
"You already are involved."
"Well, just leave me out of it then, all right? And since you're finally deigning to speak to me, I want nothing to do with you, Will. Can you understand that? I want you to leave me alone, all right?"
Neither of us says anything for a while. "I'm sorry," he says finally. "I'm sorry. But Tristan, can't you see how difficult this is for me? Can't we just, you know, can't we just be friends when we're lonely and soldiers the rest of the time?"
"Friends? That's your word for it, is it?"
"For God's sake, man," he snaps, looking around nervously.
"Keep your voice down."
I can tell that I've unsettled him. "I want us to go to Sergeant Clayton right now, where you will tell him exactly what happened with the German boy."
"I won't do it, Will."
He stares at me. And when he finally speaks, his voice is quiet and exhausted. "And that's your last word on the matter?"
"Yes."
"Fine." And with that, he turns and walks away. Norwich, September 16th, 1919. Marian and I ate lunch in the window seat of a pub on Timber Hill. The incident with Leonard Legg had been put behind us, and we settled for bland small talk instead.
I work with ex-servicemen, she told me. Men who are having difficulty coming to terms with what they've been through.
It must be very rewarding.
You'd think so, wouldn't you?
She replied, considering it.
Look, this is an awful thing to say, but I feel such resentment towards so many of them. They talk of what they've been through and the loyalty and their sense of comradeship. It makes me want to scream.
But there was loyalty. And there was, at times, an almost overwhelming sense of comradeship.
But where was the comradeship when they lined my brother up against the wall and turned their rifles on him?
She said, angrily. Don't, Marian, I begged. Her words produced terrible memories that sliced through my body.
I'm sorry, she said quietly.
She tapped the table for a moment before looking up at me.
Shall we get out of here?
This time she settled our account, and when we stepped out into the street, I followed as she led the way.
How soon was it before Will's tendencies began to show themselves?
She asked, as we walked along. I turned to her in surprise.
My brother, I don't remember him being much of a pacifist before he went away.
Well, I said, thinking about it, I believe it was a confluence of events and the sustained months of unremitting strain. But there was one incident that precipitated Will's decision to lay down his arms. But it's not a pleasant story, Marian.
Tell me about it, please. It might help to explain things.
There were four of us, you see, I said, nervous to recount it. I told her the story of Milton and Atling and how Will had found the German boy.
Do you think Will blamed himself for the boy's death?
No. He did everything he could to save the boy's life.
But what about you, Tristan?
She asked, her tone growing aggressive now. Weren't you upset by what you'd witnessed?
Of course I was.
But you didn't feel moved to join Will. You continued to fight.
I hesitated. The truth is, I simply didn't feel the same way about the incident. I was constantly witnessing men dying in the most horrific ways. It's an awful thing to say, but I allowed myself to become immune to the random acts of violence. My God, if I hadn't become immune, I would never have been able to... I pulled myself up short, astonished by the sentence that I had been about to utter.
You'd never have been able to what, Tristan?
She asked. To carry on, I suppose, I said, trying to salvage the situation. We were approaching the cathedral now. Where are we going, anyway?
I mentioned earlier that there was something I wanted you to do for me, she said quietly. It's my parents.
Your parents? And then I realized what she was getting at. My daughter has arranged something, her father had said when I had inadvertently met him outside the cathedral. I'm sorry, I said, shaking my head. No, I can't do that.
But you don't know what I want you to do.
You want me to visit your parents? To talk to them about what happened? I'm sorry, Marian, but it's out of the question.
You don't even have to talk about Will if you don't want to. But just let them meet you and know that there is a boy sitting in their front room who was friends with their son. They died over there too, Tristan. They were shot up against that wall just as my brother was. Think of your own father and mother. If, God forbid, something had happened to you over there, don't you think they would have wanted to have their minds set at ease? Please, please, say you'll come.
I knew that I had no choice. Do it, I thought. Be strong. Get it over with, then go home. And never tell her the truth about the end.
But even as I thought this, my head was dizzy with what she had said about my mother and father. What if I had died over there? Would they have cared? After the way things had ended between us, I rather thought not. Everything that took place between Peter and I, the fool I made of myself, the mistake that cost me my home. What was it my father had said to me when I was leaving? It would be best for all of us if the Germans shoot you dead on sight. Peter and I were friends from the cradle. It was always just the two of us until the Carters arrived on our street. And it wasn't long before Sylvia Carter became a near constant presence in our lives. Peter was smitten by her. And it became obvious that to try and exclude her from our company would ensure that I would be excluded from his, the idea of which was very painful to me. But then the strangest thing happened. Sylvia began to direct all her attention towards me. I was approaching 16, and I suppose I was flattered by her attentions. So I allowed Sylvia to kiss me under the chestnut tree. "Did you like it?" she asked as she pulled away. "Very much," I lied. "Do you want to do it again?" "Perhaps later." I could tell this was not the answer she expected, and my utter refusal to be seduced by her brought her campaign to a crashing end. And then, a day or two later, Peter came to see me in a state of great excitement. "There's nothing between you and Sylvia, is there?" "Of course not. Well, I had to ask," he said, smiling. "You see, the thing is that she and I... well, we're an item now, Tristan." And as the romance unfolded before my eyes, I felt bitter twists of anguish. And so I made my great mistake, the one that would see me expelled from school, home and family, and from the only life I had ever known. It was a school day, and I was alone with Peter in the classroom. He was telling me about Sylvia. My Sylvia. The words revolted me. It was obvious how much she meant to him. And without pausing to think about the consequences of my actions, I reached forward, took his face in my hands, and kissed him. He pulled away in shock and stared at me in confusion, then repulsion. Of course, I knew instantly that I had made a terrible miscalculation. "Peter..." But he was already running from the room. It's an astonishing thing. We had been friends all our lives, but I never laid eyes on him again after that. Not once. I didn't return to class that afternoon. I went home and lay upon my bed, the tears coming quickly. I was still there when our headmaster appeared in the shop downstairs, to inform my father of the complaint that had been made against me of the most hideous and vile nature, and to instruct him that I was no longer welcome in his school. I was sent away from home later that day, and within weeks most of the bruises and welts that my father had inflicted on me had begun to heal. I made no protest as I was kicked out onto the street. The vicarage reminded me of something from a picture postcard, with its immaculate front lawn and flower beds. It was a stark contrast to the small flat above the butcher's shop where I spent my first 16 years. Marian led me into the parlour. "Mr. Sadler," said Mrs. Bancroft, "it's so good of you to call." "It's my pleasure," I said, smiling at her, lying.
As I sat down, the door opened and Reverend Bancroft entered.
"Mr. Sadler," he said, taking my hand. "I'm sorry I was delayed. I trust my wife and daughter have kept you entertained."
"He's not here for entertainment, Father," snapped Marian. "My daughter said that you were in possession of some letters, Mr. Sadler," said Mrs. Bancroft.
"Yes," I said, grateful for the diversion.
I reached in my pocket for the letters and placed them on the table before me. Marian stared at them, a collection of envelopes tied up in red ribbon, her neat handwriting visible on the uppermost one. "Excuse me a minute," she said suddenly, rushing from the room. "Our daughter might come across a little brittle at times, Mr. Sadler," said Mrs. Bancroft. "But she loved her brother very much. His death has damaged her badly."
"I think I can understand her grief." "You knew our son well then, Mr. Sadler?"
asked Reverend Bancroft after a moment.
"We were good friends, sir. We trained at Aldershot and..." "Yes, yes," he said quickly, waving this aside. "Do you know where I was this afternoon?"
I shook my head.
"I thought you might have overheard us. This morning, I mean, at the cathedral."
I felt my cheeks redden.
"You recognized me then?" "Yes. My daughter had already told me of your impending visit, and you're the same age as William. Anyway, I was with a group of parishioners. There is a plan to erect a monument, some type of large stone sculpture with the name of every boy from Norwich who laid down his life. It's happening all around England. You must have heard of it."
"Of course."
"Well, today was the day when the final decisions were being made, and I, as vicar, was required to be there. Can you understand what that is like, Mr. Sadler?" he asked me, his eyes filling with tears. "To be told that your own son, who has given his life for his country, cannot be represented on the stone because of his cowardice. It's monstrous. That's what it is."
"I'm very sorry."
"And what does sorry do? Does it bring my boy back to me? A name on a stone, it means nothing really, but it still means something."
He hesitated for a moment now, and then smiled at me. "But I'm pleased that you survived, Mr. Sadler. Truly I am. Your parents must have been pleased to have you back safely." "Well, I don't know about that," I told him.
"We're not close.
But they know you're alive and well," Mrs. Bancroft asked.
"I think so. I've written, but I've never received any replies."
She stared at me with an expression of outright ferocity on her face.
"What kind of people are they, Mr. Sadler? Are they monsters?"
During my final week before Aldershot, I decided to pay a visit to my family. Although we had not spoken in more than 18 months, I felt there might be the possibility of a reconciliation in the face of my uncertain future. I felt strangely calm as I made my way towards Chiswick High Street. I had, for the most part, been happy there as a child. It was true that my father was often violent with me, but my mother had always been kind. I felt that I would like to see her again. But as I got closer to home, I found my nerves beginning to overwhelm me. I glanced at my watch, wondering whether to abandon the whole idea, and it was then that I collided with a person walking towards me.
"Sylvia." "Tristan."
"It's good to see you," I said.
"And you? You're not yet?"
"Tomorrow morning. Aldershot."
"Oh, you're back to see your family then?"
"Yes. It might be the last time, after all."
"Don't say that, Tristan. It's bad luck."
She reached out and touched my arm. "I wanted to write to you, you know, when I realized what we'd done to you."
"It was hardly your fault."
"No, but I had a hand in it. I only went with Peter because you rejected me. It seems so silly now, doesn't it?"
"Yes. And Peter, is he still..."
"Oh, no. He's in the Navy now. And he and I didn't last. He was rather selfish, really, when you think of it. You were such close friends, and the moment he realised how you..."
how you really felt. It dropped you like a hot potato. Vile.
I shrugged. My feelings for Peter hadn't entirely evaporated, although I could now recognise them for what they really were. An adolescent crush. But I liked to think that he was still my friend, and that if we ever met again, that all past enmities would be forgotten. Of course, we never did. Well, I said, I should be getting along. I glanced down the street towards my father's shop. Let's hope that one of the three of them will be happy to see me. A look of horror fell across Sylvia's face.
The three of them? She said, echoing my phrase. Oh, Tristan.
There were no customers in the shop, and no one behind the counter. And then my father emerged from the cold room.
With you in a minute, sir,
he said, barely glancing in my direction as he placed a tray on the counter. Then he looked up, and to his credit appeared to be at a loss for words, but then a look of disgust spread across his face. I go tomorrow, I told him. I have 9 weeks of training at Aldershot, and then I go. He nodded. Well, I'm not sure why you thought I'd be interested. So unless you're after a bit of mince, or...
Why didn't you tell me?
Tell you what?
She was my sister, for pity's sake. He had the decency to look away.
You couldn't have done anything to help her. It spread through her body like wildfire.
I would have wanted to see her. I'm her brother. To my surprise, he came around the counter and put an arm around my shoulder, and I thought he was going to embrace me, but instead, he walked me towards the door.
The truth is, Tristan, he said as he guided me onto the street, you weren't her brother any more than you're my son. This isn't your family, not any more. It would be best for all of us if the Germans shoot you dead on sight.
He closed the door in my face then, and turned back into the shop, and out of my life forever.
Perhaps that wasn't such a good idea,
said Marian, as we made our way back through the city.
It's all right. I lit a much-needed cigarette to calm my nerves.
I picked up my holdall from Mrs. Cantwell's boarding house, and then we walked towards the station.
What are your plans for the future? Marian asked.
Well, tomorrow morning I shall be back at my desk at the Wispy Press, I said. But eventually I might like to try my hand at writing. It was the first time I had admitted this aloud to anyone.
I wish you luck, she said, taking my arm. I was both flattered and upset by the gesture. I had spent so much time planning this meeting, and here I was, ready to return home, and I still had not steeled myself to tell her about her brother's last hours. She must have been thinking the same thing, for as we entered the station, she stopped. I need to know the truth about what happened, Tristan. There's something you're not telling me.
I took a deep breath, thinking, will I tell her? Can I tell her?
Your hand, Tristan. What's the matter with it?
My index finger was trembling erratically. I can tell you everything about that last day, I said finally in a quiet voice. Only I'm not sure that it will offer you any solace. And you certainly won't be able to forgive.
It doesn't matter. It's the not knowing that is most painful.
All right, then.
September to October 1916.
Hobbs has gone mad. He stands outside my foxhole and stares down at me, giggling like a girl. "What's the matter with you?" I ask, in no mood for games. He just laughs hysterically. Eventually, two medics arrive and they take him away. 13 of our number gone. 7 left. I manage to sleep for a while, but when I wake, I find that I am shaking uncontrollably. My whole body is in spasm. Robinson finds me and is taken aback by the sight.
"Sparks,"
I hear him say.
"Come and take a look at this."
Then a second voice.
"His number's up."
Soon, I'm transported to the medical tent and find myself lying on a bunk for the first time in I don't know how long, covered in warm blankets. I float in and out of consciousness, and when I finally come to, I find a doctor looking down at me, and next to him is Sergeant Clayton.
"Best thing for him is to be shipped back home for convalescence," the doctor is saying.
"For God's sake, man, if he can convalesce there, he can convalesce here," insists Clayton. "Get him back on his feet, then send him back to me. Understood?"
A sigh, then,
"Understood, sir."
As I close my eyes and drift off again, I begin to wonder whether the entire scenario was a dream. This sense of confusion continues for most of the day, but then the next morning, as I wake to the sound of rain pelting down on the canvas tent, I feel the fog lifting from my mind.
"Ah, Sadler," says the doctor. "You look better today. We thought we were going to lose you at first."
"How long have I been here?"
"A week."
"Did I have any visitors?"
"Who were you expecting? The Archbishop of Canterbury?"
I ignore his sarcasm. "So what's next for me, then?"
"Back to active duty, I expect."
And the following afternoon, I'm sent back to the trenches. No one mentions Will, and I am nervous to ask after him. When a group of 60 men action a recce towards the German defences, only 18 return. A disaster by any standards. Among the dead is Corporal Moody. Later that same evening, I discover Corporal Wells sitting alone with a cup of tea, his head bowed over the table, and I feel unexpected sympathy for him. "I'm sorry to hear about Corporal Moody, sir," I say. He looks up and nods. He looks exhausted. "But how are you? Better?"
"Quite well, sir. Thank you."
"Good. Last thing we need, another man going down. There's only 6 left of your original Aldershot troop, isn't there?"
7, I say. "Robinson, Williams, Atling, Sparks, Milton, Bancroft and me."
Corporal Wells laughs.
"We don't include Bancroft. You haven't heard, then?"
I shake my head. "Private Bancroft," begins Wells, "brought up that whole business of the German boy again. You heard about that, I imagine?"
"I was there when it happened, sir."
"Oh, that's right. Anyway, he wanted Milton brought up on charges. Sergeant Clayton refused, and, well, Bancroft announced he would take no further part in the campaign. You two were friends once, weren't you?"
"We bunked next to each other in training, that's all," I replied.
"But what's going to happen to Bancroft now?"
"Well, Sergeant Clayton told him that he couldn't register as a conscientious objector. It was too late for that nonsense. But he's gone the whole hog now and declared himself an absolutist."
"A what?"
"An absolutist," Wells repeats. "It's one step beyond conscientious objecting. An absolutist won't fight, won't help those who are fighting, won't work in a hospital or come to the aid of the wounded. Won't do anything at all, really. Cowardice on the most extreme level."
"Will's not a coward," I say quietly. "Oh, but he is. Anyway, he's registered his status, and the only thing left is to decide what to do with him."
"So where is he?"
I ask, already feeling heartsore at the idea that I might not see him again, that like Peter Wallace, Will and I parted as enemies, and I might die without ever being reconciled.
Locked up at Sergeant Clayton's discretion, court-martialed.
But there hasn't been a trial yet.
We don't need a trial out here, Sadler. But there's a big push coming over the next 24 hours. If he agrees to get back into the thick of it, all will be forgotten. For now, at least.
He drains his mug and stands up. Are you sure that you and Bancroft aren't friends?
We just had bunks next to each other, I say.
I barely know him, really. To my astonishment, I see Will the following evening, seated alone in a foxhole near HQ. He's unshaven and pale. There's a lost expression on his face.
I thought they locked you up, I say, as I approach him.
They have. They'll take me back in a bit, I dare say. There's a meeting taking place in HQ and Wells told me to wait here.
Wells told me what you're doing. Is it because of the German boy?
He's part of it. But there's Wolf, too. It just feels like we've all become immune to the violence.
I'm of the opinion that Sergeant Clayton would burst into tears if he heard that the war had come to an end.
The man's half mad. But look, Tristan, I haven't asked how you are.
I'm fine. The doctor didn't give you much chance when I spoke to him. Bloody fool. I told him you'd pull through.
But they told me no one came to visit. He shrugs. Well, I came. I take a seat beside him. I can't stop thinking about the fact that he visited me, about what that means.
Can't you put your concerns aside until the war's over? I ask.
But the point must be made while the fighting is still going on. Otherwise, it's entirely worthless. Will turns and stares at me. Why do you care so much anyway?
I care for the same reason that you visited me in hospital, I say. I don't want to see you make a terrible mistake that you'll regret for the rest of your life.
And you don't think you'll regret it? He asks, his voice growing colder now.
When this is all over, and you're safely back in London, you don't think you'll wake up with pictures of all the men you've killed haunting your dreams?
I can't sleep at night, Tristan, for thinking of that boy pissing his pants just before Milton put a gun to his head. I wish I'd put a bullet in Milton myself before he could kill the boy.
You'd have been shot for it if you had.
I'll be shot anyway. What do you think they're discussing back there?
They won't shoot you. I insist. They have to hear your case.
Not out here, they don't.
And then there's a cry of, Bancroft!
And I turn to see Harding, the new corporal sent from GHQ to replace Moody.
Who the hell are you?
He asks, as I jump to my feet.
A Private Sadler, sir,
I say.
Well, get back to your trench, Sadler.
Yes, sir. I turn and nod at Will before I leave. He doesn't acknowledge my farewell, just stares at me as I walk away. The silence is astonishing.
Sergeant Clayton addresses 40 of us standing in pathetic lines in front of him.
To my surprise, Will is present, standing between Wells and Harding. He has a haunted look and barely glances up from the ground.
Clayton is shouting at us, telling us how brave we've been over the last 8 hours one moment, then condemning us as a bunch of frightened mice the next.
He was never completely sane, I think, but he's lost it entirely now.
And this man here,
shouts Clayton then, marching over to Will.
This man who refuses to fight, this bloody coward.
He walks away, then a moment later walks back, pulls off a glove and slaps Will across the face with it. We're immune to violence, of course, but the action takes each of us a little by surprise.
This man,
he declares,
has refused to fight. In the light of this, he has been duly court-martialed and found guilty of cowardice. He will be shot tomorrow morning at 6 o'clock.
Will looks up now, but doesn't seem to care. I stare at him, willing him to turn his head in my direction. But he doesn't. It's night time now. Dark, surprisingly quiet. I make my way back to my foxhole past a group of medics who are placing casualties on stretchers. I glance at them for only a few moments and see Atling, Williams, and Robinson. On the stretcher behind them lies the body of Milton, the murderer of the German boy, dead now, too. There's only three of us left. Sparks, Will, and I. How have I survived this long? I can't sleep, of course. The hours pass and I watch the horizon, willing the sun not to rise. At about 3 o'clock, I walk through the trench, my mind elsewhere, and stumble over a pair of outstretched feet. Oh, for God's sake, Marshal, I say, looking down and seeing one of the new recruits. Keep yourself tidy, can't you? What's it to you? It isn't something I plan. And even as I see my arm reach out, I am almost surprised by what I'm doing. But I flip his helmet off his head and send it flying into the mud. For God's sake, man, he cries, jumping up. What did you do that for? Pick it up. Get it yourself, Marshal. Afraid to fight, are you? Marshal says after a moment, looking around at the other men for support. Like that pal of yours. What's his name? Bancroft. Will is not afraid to fight, I say, stepping forward. Oh, it's Will, is it? He asks, laughing contemptuously. But in a second, my fist has made contact with his jaw, and I send him flying off his feet. I'm barely aware of what's taking place, but it feels as if months of internalized pain are suddenly pouring out, and I find myself astride him, punching him time and time again. There he is, his face pulling back in the schoolroom after I kissed him. There he is, embracing me by the stream at Aldershot before pulling his clothes together with a look of contempt and revulsion, and there again somewhere in the back of the lines telling me that men just sought comfort where they could find it at times like this. I punch at every one of them, and Marshall takes the blows, and the world seems very black, even as I feel arms dragging me off the boy as the men cry, "Enough, for God's sake, you'll kill him!"
You're a bloody disgrace, Sadler,
yells Sergeant Clayton.
How are the new recruits expected to fight if they have the living shit beaten out of them by you?
Obviously, it wasn't wise, sir, I say.
Not wise,
he roars.
That's a bloody understatement. Woken up for this. Still,
he adds, softening his tone,
that ignorant fool needed taking down a peg or two. Look here, Sadler. I can't let this sort of thing go unpunished. He'll spend the next few hours in confinement.
He shouts for Corporal Harding, who enters a moment later.
Take Private Sadler into confinement until sunrise, will you? But there's only the cell where we're holding Bancroft, sir.
And he's meant to be in solitary.
Well, they can be in solitary together. Now get out of here, the pair of you.
Surprised, says Will, sounding amused despite the circumstances. I wouldn't have taken you for a scrapper. Were you like that in school? On occasion, I say, sitting down on a bunk. Why? Were you? Sometimes. And yet now you won't fight at all. He smiles then, his eyes focusing on mine. And is that what you're here for, really? To persuade me to change my mind? I've told you exactly why I'm here, but I think we can fight your sentence. If you offer to get straight back into the thick of it, Clayton will let you off. He needs every soldier he can get. I can't do it, Tris, he says. I'd like to, I really would. I don't want to die.
Then don't die, Will, I say. Just tell me what you want me to do to put this madness to an end.
I want you to tell Sergeant Clayton that Milton killed that boy in cold blood. But Milton is dead. What's to be gained? I knew you wouldn't. Do you see the irony of it all, Tristan? That I am to be shot as a coward while you get to live as one.
Oh,
You're impossible to talk to. And where are your high-minded principles when it comes to the rest of your life?
Oh, Tristan, he says with a sigh. Please don't bring up that business again, not now. You speak as if it meant nothing.
But it did mean nothing, Tristan.
My God, what's the matter with you anyway? Are you so emotionally crippled that you can't understand what comfort is when it stands in front of you?
Comfort? I ask, astonished. Do you know, if it had been a once-off, perhaps then I could have understood it. But it was you, Will. It was you who led me the second time.
Look, I have to say it. Our time is running out. Does it matter at all that I love you?
Don't speak like that, he hisses. What if we were overheard? I don't care, I say, moving towards him.
Get away from me! To hear you say what you just said, well, it turns my stomach.
I don't love you, Tristan. I don't even like you anymore.
When I think of what we've done together, it makes me sick.
Please, Will. I say, tears of anger spilling down my cheeks. We're friends.
We're not friends,
he shouts. We never were friends. Can't you understand that, you fool? He marches to the door and bangs on it, shouting,
get him out of here! I want a few minutes' peace before I die.
Will, I say, but he shakes his head. Still, he pulls me to him one last time. Listen to me, he whispers. I am not like you. I wish to God I had never met you. Wolf told me about you, told me what you were, and I stayed your friend out of pity. But I despise you, Tristan. I feel dizzy. I would never have believed that he could be so cruel. I open my mouth, but find I have no words for him. And at that moment, I hear footsteps running down towards the door. I stand in the courtyard, feeling as if my head will explode. There's a fireball of fury within me. All he made me do, all he said to me, the way he led me on. I want to go back down there, grab him by the neck and bang his head on the stone floor until his brains have spilled out. I love him, but I want him to die. I cannot live in a world where he exists.
I need one more,
shouts Sergeant Clayton. Wells shakes his head.
I can't, sir. It has to be an enlisted man.
I look in front of me at the firing squad already assembled. It's 6 o'clock. 5 men in a row, all looking terrified. A gap for the sixth. I march over.
You need a sixth man.
No, Sadler, says Wells, staring at me in astonishment.
Not you.
I said I'll do it, I say, picking up the sixth rifle as the hatred courses through my veins.
There we are, then,
snaps Sergeant Clayton, signalling the guardsman to open the door.
Bring him up. It's time.
Sadler, think about this for God's sake. This is Wells. But I take my place in the line. I want Will's head on a plate.
Corporal Wells, get out of the way,
snaps Sergeant Clayton. And then I see him. I see Will being led up the steps, a black mask over his eyes, a piece of red cloth pinned above his heart. I stare at him. I remember everything, and it is all I can do not to rush at him and tear him limb from limb. Sergeant Clayton gives the order for us to stand to attention, rifles raised. What are you doing? I think. A voice of reason in my head. A voice I choose to ignore.
Take aim!
Cries Clayton. And in that moment, Will, brave to the last, whips his blindfold away, wanting to face his killers. His expression is one of fear, but strength too. Resilience. And then he notices me standing in the line, and his expression changes. He is shocked. He stares. His face collapses. Tristan, he says, his last word. The command comes, and the index finger of my right hand presses the trigger, and in a heartbeat, 6 guns have discharged. Mine as quickly as anyone's. And my friend lies on the ground, his war over, mine about to begin.
Thank you.
London, October 1979. I saw her once again. It was almost 60 years later. My 81st birthday had been reported in the newspapers, and a literary society had decided to present me with a prestigious award for my work. I went along to a dinner, and speeches were made and books signed. I stayed in a hotel in London on the night, having left the city some years earlier and retired, as they say, to the country. I said my goodbyes, and at a respectable hour, returned to the hotel, looking forward to a decent night's sleep. "There's a lady waiting to see you," the porter said as I collected my key. "A lady?" "She said to tell you that she'd come from Norwich." I made my way into the lounge nervously. It was busy, but there was no mistaking her. "I read of your award in the newspaper," Marian told me without any preamble as I sat down. "And I happened to be in London for my grandson's wedding. I hope you don't mind my calling on you." "I'm glad you did," I replied politely, although I wasn't certain exactly how I felt to see her again. "I suppose I should congratulate you on your award," she said, nodding at the waiter to refill her wine glass. I ordered a small whiskey, then changed my mind and increased the measure. "I remember that day, just before we parted," she said, "you told me you hoped to start writing, and now there's an impressive number of books to your name. I've never read any of them, I have to admit." "Is that rude?" "Not at all," I said. "Do you ever think of me, Tristan?" "Most days," I admitted. "And my brother?" "Most days." She looked away now. "Tell me about your life, Marian," I said. "The last image I had of her was sitting on a platform at Thorpe Station, weeping and then charging towards the glass of my window seat as the train pulled out of the station. If she had got her hands on me, she might have killed me, and I might have let her." "Well," she said, "I trained as a teacher after my marriage broke up. I'm retired now, obviously. I have 3 children. Alice is a vet, Helen is a psychologist, and then there's my son." "Does he have a name?" "Of course he has a name," she said, looking away. And I realized suddenly what it was. I reached for my drink, my safety ground. "My son has struggled with life, if I'm honest," she said, after a moment. "I don't know why. I do what I can for him, of course." "And his father?" "Oh, Leonard is long gone. Emigrated to Australia and was killed in a fire." "Leonard? Not Leonard Legg? Of course, you met him that day, didn't you?" "He punched me in the face." "But you were so set against him." "Well, I went back to him the day after you left. I needed someone to take care of me at that moment. And he was there. But let's stop talking about me. What about you, Tristan? You never married?" "No," I said, looking away. "And there was never, ever a companion?" "No, not a single person, not once. No liaisons of any description." "Wasn't it lonely?" "Yes." "Yes, well, but have you been happy?" I thought about it. "I've not been unhappy, but, like your son, I have struggled at times."
"With what?"
"Can I say his name?"
"No," she hissed.
I nodded. "I have lived with the shame of my actions for 63 years. There hasn't been a single day I haven't thought about it." "I'm surprised you haven't written about it, if you feel that strongly." "I have."
"So why haven't you published it, then?"
"I suppose the shame would be too much for me. But it won't matter after I've gone." "You're a coward, Tristan, aren't you? Terrible coward." "Yes, I suppose I am."
She sighed and stood up, her expression suggesting that she might scream if she wasn't careful. I don't know why I came here. Goodbye, Tristan. We shan't meet again. No. And with that, she was gone. She was right, of course. I have been a coward. I should have delivered this manuscript years ago. Perhaps I was waiting for the story to find a conclusion of sorts, and it has finally come tonight. I returned to my room after she left. Holding my right hand out, I noticed that my spasmodic index finger was perfectly still now, the finger that had pulled the trigger that sent the bullet into my lover's heart, satisfied at last. I remove the manuscript from my briefcase. I keep it close at hand, and I write now of my final encounter with Marian. And then I reach into my case for something else, something I also keep close at hand, for the moment when it feels right to use it. Soon they will find me here in this bedroom, and the police will be called, and the ambulance, and I will be carried away to the morgue. And tomorrow the newspapers will run my obituary and say, what a shame, but look at the legacy he's left behind to honour his memory. And soon afterwards this manuscript will appear, my final book. There'll be outrage and disgust, and my reputation will be forever destroyed. My punishment earned, self-inflicted like this gunshot wound. And the world will finally know that I was the greatest feather man of all.